This is the Øresund Bridge. At nearly 5 miles, it is the longest combined road and rail bridge in Europe, connecting the Danish capital of Copenhagen and the Swedish city of Malmö. Famous for its appearance in the acclaimed crime drama The Bridge, this impressive feat of engineering symbolizes the bond between Scandinavian countries. This month, I want to look at this relationship between Sweden, Norway, and Denmark. How are they similar? And how are they different? And just how this region produces such a number of great golfers. I make my way to Gothenburg to meet Solheim Cup captain Carin Koch to see how she plans to lead Europe to victory against the United States this month.
It's a very proud moment of my career, of course, just to be captain and to be asked to be captain. It's quite amazing.
We head up to Lofoten in northern Norway to meet the country's poster girl and Europe's number one, Susanne Pettersen.
You just get so much more than just golf here. It's an experience of raw nature. It's a good place to recharge your batteries.
And we travel to Helsingør in Denmark to cover an event that puts Scandinavian harmony to the test.
There's still a little big brother, baby brother feel to it, and of course we're the big brother since we're the bigger and better and more beautiful country than Denmark.
What is going through the mind of Carin Koch? The Swedish star will soon try to lead Europe to a third successive victory against the USA in the Solheim Cup. There's plans to make, tactics to tinker with, players to pick. The pressure is on.
It is a challenge, of course. It's been a challenge working with it for the last year and a half. I'm just so excited and having a lot of fun with all the preparations, and the week is just going to be fantastic. I love match play, I love the team spirit, the team atmosphere. I feel very prepared for the week so that I don't get too many surprises, and to be with the players for the week and just make it a fantastic memory for them.
I've caught up with Carin at the Hills Golf Club just outside Gothenburg. Precious time in her calendar away from team preparations.
What do you like though with regard to kind of taking notes or something comes into your head? I mean, are you building a file, or how has it been over the last year and a bit?
My computer is full. There's a lot of files. No, but you know, I try to learn as I go along. I had a couple of good discussions with Paul McGinley, got some good advice from him. You know, I have such a good experienced team behind me that I feel really, really good.
In the history of Swedish golf, it's easy to get sidetracked by the career of Annika Sörenstam. But Koch has had her own share of success. 4 hard-earned pro wins and an impressive 10-3-3 record in the Solheim Cup meant she was an automatic choice to become captain when the time came.
The American side, I mean, do you find them intimidating in any way at all?
Well, you know, they're going to have 12 good players. They're up there high on the world rankings and just great competitors. But we're going to have, you know, just as good of a team, I think. You know, I get the question a lot if I feel more pressure because we've won the last two. And I think the pressure's on them. You know, you don't want to lose 3 in a row.
Facing Carin is one of the fiercest competitors in women's golf. American captain Julie Engster.
I'm not sure if I should bring this up, but you did have a match against Julie that maybe didn't go your way in the Solheim Cup.
Why do you bring that up?
Just to get a reaction out of you.
I have so much respect for Julie. I've always looked up to her. She had kids on tour early. She was a great player, a fun person, but so competitive and so fierce. So I guess she's one up against me, so I can try to come back from that one.
Fashion is one of Carin's many passions away from the course, and it's no surprise that she's been instrumental in the designs of the all-important Solheim Cup outfits.
I mean, there is a saying, look good, feel good, play good. Is that something that you buy into?
Definitely. You know, I think it's important to feel good by wearing something that you feel, you know, very pretty in, and that's fashionable and also comfortable.
Carin, the devil is in the details. So let's get started with Friday. This is when they go into battle.
Well, you know, we finished off playing in blue outfits on Sunday in Colorado and did pretty good there. So we figured we'd just kind of keep that momentum going and start with a nice blue, very feminine kind of powder blue color on the Friday in Germany.
Saturday is very feminine, obviously with pink.
The team has never wore pink before. Yeah. So just bringing that in, I love the sweater with the gray and the white and the pink.
It's stuff that you really feel comfortable wearing, your kind of colors, your kind of style.
I wear this a lot. Yeah, I wear this pink a lot.
So as you lead into Sunday, this is the big one.
We have this really strong blue, I call it European blue color, that I really like. It looks good on everybody. Hopefully we get a lot of the crowd to wear that as well.
And for the players as well, it just gives you that team spirit because it is a uniform, it's a badge every day.
Definitely, we don't get to do that on any other week, so it gives you just that feeling of being a team, and it's important that it's clothing that you look good in and feel good in, and then you'll play good in it.
At the Hills Academy, the next generation of Annikas and Karens practice hard in the Swedish summer. For a population of under 10 million people, the development of such a number of top players in the women's and men's game in recent years is impressive. So what is their secret?
We have very good programs at the clubs with juniors. Juniors have pretty much always been very welcome at the clubs. It's very much a family sport in Sweden to play golf. And then at the national level, if you do make it, you know, to national teams, and they really take care of you and have a very good program.
Despite strong foundations, Sweden, like many other countries, is suffering from dwindling numbers of youngsters taking up the game. Carin is hopeful the cup can be a catalyst for change.
Do you genuinely believe we're going to see progress in that regard?
I truly hope so. I mean, the Solheim Cup is our chance to showcase women's golf in all over the world. It's going to be broadcast, you know, in so many countries. And we're putting on the best golfers, the best golf in a fun format with match play, with a lot of crowds, fun, loud, you know, and hopefully there'll be a lot of people that don't play golf that'll watch and realize, wow, that's a fun sport. And it's very competitive. And, you know, if we can inspire a few people around the world to watch more golf and, of course, play more golf, then we've succeeded with the Solheim Cup.
And are you telling your teammates to never forget that, that they are actually representing the sport? And this is almost like the perfect display of that.
Definitely. You know, my team will know that they're on a stage where they have the opportunity for Europe, to represent Europe, and for themselves as well. But it is their biggest showcase, and to really take advantage of that.
The Solheim Cup stage is almost set. Is Carin ready for her close-up?
It means a lot to me to do my best and to be a great captain and to create an environment for the players that will give them, you know, all the chances to really perform their best, to feel that everything's prepared for them and they can just go out and play. Then I can't do that much more. But I want to walk out of the week and feel like I've done my best, I've been a good captain, and I've created that environment around the players. They are going to bring a great memory from the week that they'll never forget.